Namaskar, I'm Nidhi Sekho. In this video, I'll be explaining the fourth school of miniatures, that is the Deccan School of Miniature Painting. Let's look at the map first so that we are able to understand the Deccan region. The region that falls between Narmada and Krishna rivers is called as Deccan. This is a little highland, that's why it is also called plateau. There were five sultanates which were part of the Deccan kingdom. They were Ahmednagar, Berar, Bidar, Bijapur and Golconda. The dynasty that ruled in Ahmednagar, they were called Nizam Shahis. Adil Shahi dynasty ruled in Bijapur. In Golconda, there were Qutub Shahis and in Hyderabad, they were called Asafiya dynasty or Asaf Jahi dynasty. In this area, that is the Deccan region, there was also a very powerful Hindu dynasty, also called Sangama dynasty or Raya dynasty in Vijayanagar. This dynasty had created two very important temples, one Veerbhadra temple at Lepakshi and second Virupaksha temple at Hampi. So we also see influence of these temples, the art of these temples in Deccan miniatures. Now let's look at the origin and development. Like I explained in the map, the Deccani form of miniature painting began during the reign of Bahmani Sultanate that established itself in around 1347. They won a battle of Talikota against the Hindu kings of Vijayanagar. Here, art in all forms of music, painting and architecture flourished thereafter. Early centers of painting were Ahmednagar, Bijapur, Golconda during 16th and 17th centuries. Paintings were generally made by Hindu artists trained in Vijayanagar style of Hampi and Lepakshi. This Deccani school continued to develop independently of Mughal style in the beginning for almost 100 years. Later, the Mughal painters who migrated to Deccan during the period of Aurangzeb brought the influence of Mughal style of painting. So this Deccan art became a blend of native Deccan traditions of Hindu art of Vijayanagar along with the Islamic styles of Turkey and Persia. The first sub-school of Deccan miniatures is Ahmednagar. The main patrons who supported art were Hussain Nizam Shah I, Murtuza Nizam Shah II and Burhan Nizam Shah II. The earliest example of Ahmednagar miniatures is Tarif-e-Hussain Shahi. It is a volume of poems written on Sultan Nizam Shah I who fought very bravely against Vijayanagar. This manuscript was commissioned by his widowed queen in his honour. This manuscript is now preserved in Bharat Itihas Samshodak Mandal, Pune. This is one painting from Tarif-e-Hussain Shahi which shows king sitting on a throne being attended by a lot of females. When we look at the painting, we see various influences. Now look at the way these females are shown. They look like they belong to northern tradition of Malwa. The cholis that they are wearing, the braids, there are small latkans on their braids which look like they belong to North India. But the long scarf which is kind of passing around their body is done in southern fashion, which looks like the influence of Lepakshi murals. The colors used in the painting are rich and brilliant and they also look like the northern paintings. The Persian influence we can see in high horizon, golden sky and the landscape shown in the painting. Other examples from Ahmednagar are Hindola Rag of about 1590, portraits of Burhan Nizam Shah II of Ahmednagar and of Malik Ambeer of about 1605-AD, which are kept in National Museum, New Delhi and various other museums. Our second sub-school is Bijapur. The main patrons of art were Ali Adil Shah I and Ibrahim Adil Shah II. This Ibrahim Adil Shah II was a connoisseur, he was an expert of Indian music and he also wrote the book called Norasnama. Adil Shah invited Persian and Turkish painters, calligraphers and scholars to his court. Paintings were made on pure Islamic themes and in pure Islamic style. It was Indian only to the extent that it was made on Indian soil. An important work was made here, which was an encyclopedia known as Najm al-Ulum, also called Stars of Sciences. It is preserved in Chester Beattie Library, Dublin, and it was illustrated in around 1570 during the reign of Ali Adil Shah I. This manuscript contains 876 miniatures. The ladies which appear in the paintings are tall, they are thin and they are wearing South Indian dresses. There is influence of Ottoman, that is Turkish manuscripts in planetary paintings of this encyclopedia. This is an example of one of the paintings called Throne of Prosperity from Nujum al-Ulum. It shows seven stages in seven stories made in broad rectangular steps, which are filled with figures of elephants, tigers, palm trees and tribal people. The foliage, that is the floral patterns that we see, are influenced by border decorations of Gujarat manuscripts. And there is clear influence of Lepakshi mural paintings on depiction of females and rich color scheme. The palm trees, animals, men and women all belong to Deccan tradition. There is lavish use of golden color, some flowering plants and arabesques, that is the dome structures, the architectural structures that you see on the top of the throne. They are all from the Persian tradition. The earliest series of Ragmala paintings are also found in Bijapur. Some historians even believe that Ragmala paintings originated in Bijapur. Dhanasri Ragini is an important example in which we see the fusion of Indian motifs, Sanskrit script, Persian calligraphy and architecture, and Lepakshi style costumes. Other examples that you can write are Yogini with a bird. There are a lot of Yogini paintings done in Deccan region or in miniatures. And this painting specially was painted in about 1605 AD and is in the collection of Chester Beatty Library, Dublin. Our third subschool is Golconda. The main patrons were Quli Qutub Shah, Ibrahim Qutub Shah and Abdullah Qutub Shah. This Golconda region was very rich in resources like iron, cotton and the most famous were diamonds. So trade flourished here near and far till Europe. Even the paintings of the portraits of sultans were carried by Dutch merchants to Europe. Therefore, this Deccan art was very popular outside India also. The earliest paintings which are identified as Golconda work are a group of five paintings bound in Diwan of Hafiz, which is in British Museum, London. These five miniatures were painted during the period of Sultan Abdullah Qutub Shah in about 1630 AD. Other examples that you can write for Golconda are first a portrait of Muhammad Qutub Shah, then an illustrated manuscript of a Sufi poem in the British Museum, London, which has more than 20 paintings or illustrations. Then third, you can write Scholar or Poet in a Garden, which is done by an artist named Muhammad Ali, and it's in Museum of Fine Arts, Boston. This Golconda art also contributed to various subschools of Hyderabad, Shorapur and Kurnool, etc. These are a few paintings from Diwan of Hafiz, which are in the collection of British Museum, London. Our last subschool is Hyderabad. The main patron is Asaf Jah I. Hyderabad was set up as a new capital in the foundation of Asaf Jahi dynasty by Mir Kamruddin Khan, also called Jean Kuli Khan, Nizam-ul-Mulk Asaf Jah I in 1724-80. So this subschool was later than the other previous schools. Mughal painters who migrated to the Deccan during the period of Aurangzeb got patronage in Hyderabad. And these artists were responsible for the development of various styles of painting in Deccan at Hyderabad and other centers. The important work of Hyderabad subschool is Tuzuk-e-Asafiya. It is authored by Tajalli Ali Shah. He was a scholar of Arabic and Persian. He was a historian, calligrapher, poet and an excellent artist of Hyderabad. Tuzuk-e-Asafiya contains 78 paintings. The manuscript presents a pictorial biography of this dynasty and it throws light on the socio-economic, cultural and political aspects of the rule. This is the manuscript and here are a few paintings as you can see in the pictures. In Hyderabad, Ragmala sets were also done in abundance. Many paintings done in Hyderabad show sun and moon in misty white grey sky, which is lot more advanced than the paintings done in Rajasthan, that is of Jaipur and Bhuti. Other paintings include themes of raginis, yoginis and scenes of battle. So Deccan style of painting almost ended with the Qutub Shahi dynasty of Golconda in later 17th century. But paintings kept happening till 19th century, but later Deccan style had more of Mughal influence in it. Now moving further, let us analyze a few characteristics of Deccan schools. First is the subjects. The subjects that these people took were more of portraiture, Persian literary themes, Ragmala paintings, court scenes and historical events. Next is symmetry and geometry in designs. Geometry plays an important role in the arrangement of Deccani miniatures, be it human figures, architectural structures, trees, shrubs, flowers, leaves, bolsters, cushions, folds of garments. Everything was placed to create a balance which looks very pleasing to the eye. Now, human figure. Tall, fair complexion and passionate looking males are found in Deccan art. Women are also with cylindrical bodies, lovely faces, large, wide, open eyes, bold features, broad foreheads, long necks, triangularly slanting waists and neatly carved figures. Now, costumes, that includes their dresses as well as jewelry. We see them in elegantly colored costumes, which are generally consisting of beautifully embroidered muslin coats and very fine pieces of jewelry which they are wearing. Next is eclectic art. Deccan art is eclectic art because it was a mix of various styles. The most unique part of Deccani paintings is observed in the treatment of figures, costumes, jewelry, flora and fauna, landscape and colors, where we see a mix of all Indian styles of Hampi, Lipakshi, Vijayanagar and later the style of Mughals. Then comes brilliant colors. The colors used in the paintings are rich, brilliant and are in complete harmony. The artists are very skillful in using them and they paint various forms and various moods with the help of these colors. Next interesting feature of Deccani school is that plants are painted against a mass of dark foliage, which is a very prominent Deccani feature. You can see both these examples here. Before making the plants, they have made a very dark mass of foliage, that is a lot of plants in the background on which they have highlighted a few plants. Next is Persian, European and Turkish influence. The Persian influence can be seen in high horizon, golden sky and landscape. Some flowering plants and arabesques, that is the domes that we see in architecture, they are inspired from Persian tradition. Then European influence can be seen in the realism of portraiture, perspective of depth and distance, and hence a multi-dimensional effect. Next is use of golden color. Golden color has been lavishly used in painting the architecture, costumes, jewelry and vessels, etc. Then comes decorative elements. Mostly paintings are decorative, like flower beds, uniform patterns in the background, rich colors and Deccani facial type and costumes. Artists followed the imaginary ideals of beauty and forms from literature or other sources rather than going by the realistic studies. These miniatures have more moody and romantic touch as compared to the Mughal miniatures, which are far more realistic. So though Deccan and Mughal, they are both Islamic, the treatment, the style is quite different. Now we come to the two paintings which are part of our syllabus. First is Hazrat Nizamuddin Aulia and Amir Khusro. Artist is unknown. Subschool is Hyderabad. Period is 1750 to 1770. Medium is watercolor, that is tempera on paper, and collection is the National Museum, New Delhi. The subject matter is given in the title. This is a painting of Hazrat Nizamuddin Aulia and Amir Khusro. They are both engrossed in spiritual music. Khusro was a great musician and Nizamuddin Aulia was his spiritual mentor or guide. They had a very deep devotional relationship, which is also called peer and murid relationship. It is a unique bond which is practiced in Sufi philosophy. Now, description of the painting. The two are sitting on a carpeted platform with a small red railing in front with two white steps in the center. They are both engrossed in a religious recital. Hazrat Aulia is in green robe and has folded his arms and legs, and Amir Khusro is in brown printed angrakha and is playing a stringed instrument. Khusro's face is in ek chashma and Hazrat Nizamuddin's face is in almost to chashma. The halo behind Hazrat Aulia's head has triangular rays and his face is that of a peaceful old man away from material life. Khusro though looks alert and attentive. Their turbans and robes are different as per their social, spiritual and professional status. There is a book, a bookstand and a lamp in the center on the floor. Floral beds in the background as well as the foreground are divided by a pathway. A stylized flowering tree looks very interesting in the blue sky in the background. The colors are soft and soothing. Tones are also mellowed or subdued or lightened to suit the spiritual aura of this painting with two great personalities. The second painting from our syllabus is Chan Bibi playing polo or chogan. Artist is unknown, sub-school is Golconda. Period is 18th century. The painting is from approximately 1750. Medium is tempera, which is a watercolor medium on paper. Then collection is National Museum, New Delhi. Now subject matter. This miniature shows Chan Bibi playing polo with her companions. It is said that Chan Bibi was a great horse rider and a fine polo player. She is one of the great historic Indian women who took on powerful men. She fought battles with the Mughal forces of Emperor Akbar. She was a sister of Nizam I of Ahmednagar and the widow of Ali Adil Shah I, the Sultan of Bijapur. So she was a favorite subject of Deccan artists. Now description. There are a lot of things happening in the painting and there are beautifully details. So you can write a lot. The princesses are mounted on beautifully decorated horses of white, black, dark brown and pale yellow colors. The colorful costumes and jeweled headdresses of all the princesses are painted with beautiful delicacy. In the foreground, there is a silvery gray lotus lake with white aquatic birds and the background has a receding plain depicting rocks, huts, hills and trees. Chan Bibi is riding the white horse and her companions are riding the other horses. All faces are beautiful and in profile with big open eyes and well-defined features. That is sharp nose, full lips and softly curving chin. The fascination of artists for feminine beauty ideals, that is they wanted to show females with their literary examples, has resulted in almost all faces looking similar. One lady is standing in the middle of the painting directing the game. Her hands are extended sidewards. The ball is in white color. Two players are trying to possess the ball with polo sticks, forming a cross in the center. Horses are stout and strong and they are well decorated with uplifted hoofs showing a dynamic movement. Ground is uneven with green mounds. There are few white buildings in the upper part of the painting. There is a sense of depth, there is a sense of perspective in the painting. So we see so many layers. We see the lake, we see green mounds, then we see rocks and then we see the sky. Persian delicacy can be seen in the border, illustrated above and below the painting. Pale green, yellow, brown and blue colors have been used in the background, whereas figures and horses are bright and colorful. The Persian inscription in the background reads Chogan Bazi Chand Bibi. So this painting provides a clue to the liberal lifestyle of the Deccan and depicts the interest of royal women of that time in the field of sports. That's all we have in Deccan School. Don't forget to share and subscribe so that you get notifications for more videos. So thank you very much. Best wishes to you and goodbye.